Okay, we can all please take a seat, and we're going to go to the next item. That is item number 8. And we will then return to, as you know, this committee has a number of occasions dealt with the European Union Development Cooperation with Eritrea. After largely having been suspended, this cooperation has revived the last year. The EU is funding a project to rehabilitate a road from the border with Ethiopia to the coast. There are several reasons for this, which we will soon hear about, but also a major problem. Part of the work is now carried out by people forced to participate in Eritrea's national service system. This system is widely described, including by a UN Commission of Inquiry and by our Parliament in several resolutions, as a slave labor system. We will first hear from the Commission and the UN Office for Project Services, which implements the project. The EEAS will then have the possibility to add a brief comment. Finally, Human Rights Watch will take a critical view on the project, and they will also then be given the floor. I would now like to give the floor to Sandra Kramer, who is Director of EU-African Union Relations, West and East Africa in the Commission's Development DG. You have 12 minutes to share with Rainer Franfeld from UNOPS in charge of the project, who I also wish to welcome. So please, Sandra Kramer.
If we could have a second, because she just exited the room. I'm sorry about that. We are looking for her.
Okay, that could always happen. I think we do like this then to save time. If it's okay, we will then go on and have Rainer Framner from UNOPS doing the first speech, if that's okay. Okay, please.
Good morning. Yeah, so thank you very much. I think it would have been useful to have the sequence as originally proposed in terms of introducing the project and then have Shiva. Okay, fine. Well, anyway.
Perfect.
So thank you.
Then we can all be happy. Okay, perfect. Then I would like them to give the floor to Sandra Kramer, please. 12 minutes.
Good morning, Chair, and thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here today and to have the opportunity to discuss Eritrea, which, as all of you know, is a sensitive and complex case that calls for an open exchange with the Parliament and with civil society. So I would like to set out here the status and the rationale of the EU's development cooperation with Eritrea. So the historic agreement between Ethiopia and Eritrea, concluded in 2018, offers a unique window of opportunity to support peace and to contribute to improving the situation in Eritrea. This is an ongoing process that requires progress on both sides. The EU and its member states therefore made a strategic choice to re-engage with Eritrea. We endorsed a dual-track approach of political engagement and targeted development cooperation with Eritrea. Let me underline that the EU's policy vis-à-vis Eritrea is to bring tangible benefits for Eritrea's people. With the absence of dialogue and cooperation we had in the past, we were not able to work towards that objective. In January last year, we approved a first project supporting road rehabilitation. In December, we approved a second package, further supporting road rehabilitation, in addition to job creation and national statistics. The EU support to roads is channeled through UNOPS, who are here to talk to you today. It finances the procurement and supply of material and equipment, and it does not finance labor. The project is fully monitored by the EU and UNOPS through joint field visits and dialogue with relevant authorities. And I therefore underline that the quote in the New York Times article that UNOPS is not monitoring is false. Road interconnections between Eritrea and Ethiopia are crucial to boost their economies, boost regional economic integration, and create jobs. This is a precondition for the reform of the national service in Eritrea. Road construction is a priority for the Eritrea government. It started before the EU project, and it will continue without it. The EU's support is reducing labour intensity through providing equipment and give the EU and UNOPS access to information and ability to assess the work and the labour conditions. If we are not there, works will simply continue at a much slower pace and in a more hazardous way. On the national surface, I want to make it very clear that the EU has consistently and systematically condemned the practice of the indefinite national service in Eritrea. For future support, we have made it very clear to Eritrea that more of the same is not an option for the EU and the EU member states. We're already discussing this with the Eritrean authorities' support, and there is readiness to engage in other areas to address core political issues and to meet our concerns. Trust building is hugely important in Eritrea, and the EU's engagement is bearing fruit, allowing us to discuss sensitive political issues and access more information. We're ready to discuss any future projects in Eritrea with the DEVA Committee, and as this session demonstrates, we commit to keep you closely informed about the implementation of the road projects. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Then we go on. Okay, to Rainer Franklin.
Yeah, thank you very much and good morning. So my name is Rainer Frauenfeld. I'm the director for UNOPS, the United Nations Office for Project Services for East and Southern Africa. I'm based in Nairobi, and we are working, as you have just heard, in partnership with the EU delegation in Asmara on supporting this contribution to a road rehabilitation project in Eritrea. And as the colleague has explained, this is constructed as a dual-track approach whereby the EU takes the development dialogue and political dialogue with UNOPS supporting in its technical capacity a procurement process that is carried out by the government of Eritrea through its Red Sea Trading Corporation. That's the national procurement agency. And we work with the Red Sea Corporation to support the procurement of construction equipment that is utilized by the government in its implementation of this road project. So I think it's very important to understand, and as Ms. Kramer has just mentioned, that this project is actually implemented by the government, and the confusion in the New York Times article was about who monitors what. And obviously, UNOPS monitors very carefully the implementation of its own project in partnership with the EU, which is provision of procurement support to the government. So what does that entail? So the government engages national contractors to implement the road construction and utilizes its Ministry of Public Works to supervise that road construction process. And the national companies need machines, and these machines are being bought by the National Procurement Agency. And UNOPS is administering EU money to support that procurement process. So that means the money comes to us, then the Red Sea Corporation procures, utilizing its own rules and regulations, which we have reviewed as UNOPS, as a technical procurement organization of the UN, procures construction equipment. And this happens in a two-step process. So first, the Red Sea Corporation identifies the requirements in conjunction with the construction companies. And then UNOPS, through its technical experts, reviews and revises the specifications for the equipment that is being procured. Then the Red Sea, so that's the first step of a no objection process. Then the second phase of this procurement process is the actual negotiation that's carried out by the Red Sea Corporation up to formulation of contracts with suppliers, and that then again is reviewed by UN Ops, that leads to the second no objection in that procurement process. Then the government issues the order or signs the contract with the vendor, and then the equipment is delivered to Eritrea. Upon delivery, the equipment is inspected by the government and UN Ops and the EU. And at that point, upon certification of delivery, the payment is being made by UN Ops to the international supplier of the equipment. So, and then the machines are being used in the road construction process. So that is just to sort of explain a little bit what our role is and how we then monitor the implementation of the project. So the project is to support procurement and not to build the road, because that is done by the national contracting company or by the national contracting companies. Obviously, we are doing this mindful of the context and in a dialogue jointly with the EU, with the government, and we are also including in our current procurement support the procurement of health and safety equipment for utilization in these projects. And we're also discussing the provision of training for the utilization of health and safety equipment. And I think it's probably okay if I stop at this point and then we can go further into the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Farnfeld. And I would like to give the floor to Lothar Janke, who is head of EEAS Political Press and Information Service, for 5 minutes, please.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. President. It's a privilege and honor to be here at the European Parliament and to have the opportunity to address you on the issue of Eritrea. I would like to recall the wider picture, the wider political picture. The EU's general objective to contribute to a stable, peaceful and prosper Horn of Africa. This is our general objective in the region. The stability of the Horn of Africa and the freedom of navigation from the Indian Ocean through the Red Sea to the Mediterranean are crucial to Europe. 20% of all our goods are passing there daily. It is a major priority for us to keep the region calm, working with member states and our partners. In this context, the Council of the European Union noted already in June 2018 the EU will intensify its engagement with all the countries in the Red Sea region and other relevant regional and international actors to encourage dialogue and to work to mitigate influences on regional stability. This is a clearly set out policy supported by all member states. With a 1,200-kilometer coastline on the Red Sea and two major ports, Eritrea has a strategic location in the Horn of Africa and is a strategic part of this region. And it moves. We had the historic peace declaration on the 9th of July 2018, putting an end to 60 years of hostile relations between Eritrea and Ethiopia, which was widely welcomed by the European Union and our partners. The Prime Minister Ahmed Abiy received the Nobel Peace Prize for having ended the hostilities, but the Prize Committee also mentioned the efforts of his counterpart in Asmara. High Representative Mogherini at that time called the peace declaration an historic and courageous move which paves the way for enhanced regional cooperation and stability in the Horn of Africa. She also said the European Union stands ready to mobilize the support needed to consolidate the normalization of relations and to build on between Ethiopia and Eritrea and to build on new opportunities for regional cooperation. This is what we are doing. This is what we aim to do elsewhere in the world, for example, in the Balkans, also in the European Union itself, building roads after conflicts, connecting people, establishing communication channels, fostering economic integration. Furthermore, the EU is noting positively efforts of Eritrea to open up to neighbouring countries. In September 2018, Eritrea has set in motion a trilateral cooperation with Ethiopia and Somalia, which was lately confirmed by a summit in January 2020. Relations with the new Sudan, after the following the transition, improved, and Eritrea agreed in September 2019 a defence cooperation. Eritrea also signed up in December 2019 to the new Council of African Arab States in the Red Sea and the Gulf of Aden. With Djibouti, both presidents agreed to open a new chapter of cooperation and to work towards a settlement of bilateral issues, which unfortunately are still lingering. More still needs to be done on this front. As for the European Union, the EU has been present in Eritrea since independence. Relations have sometimes been difficult until new regional dynamics opened up a window of opportunity, as was mentioned by Director Sandra Kramer, for more constructive engagement. In 2019, we had two political dialogue meetings in Asmara, where we discussed migration, human rights, regional issues and economic reforms. This is an excellent opportunity to pass our messages to encourage openness and signal support for reforms necessary to demobilize from the national service, and also encourage them to communicate, and one result was the communication on the national service. In addition, the European Union Special Representative for Human Rights, Eamon Gilmore, had two meetings with Councillor of the Prime Minister, of the President, but in Eritrea realities this is a super minister, and the Foreign Minister of Eritrea. He is the only foreign official with human rights in his title who has access to Asmara. A third meeting is scheduled to take place on 25th of February in Geneva. We have noted that Eritrea has engaged in the Universal Periodic Review exercise in January 2019 and accepted 131 recommendations, which it wants to implement until June 2024, including on civil and political rights such as abolishing the death penalty, combating human trafficking, promoting freedom of religion and belief. The dual track approach, which is our policy of constructive engagement, was mentioned here. The dual track approach has opened up space for more engagement as well as concrete cooperation. Eritrea also seems to be more open for a wider cooperation on governance issues such as diaspora, police reform and justice reform, judged by our contacts and the contacts of the United Nations. We, the European institutions and the Member States, all agree on the need to help Eritrea reform its national service, respect human rights, and build an economic base that Eritrea needs to create jobs and attract investments and withstand the forces of competition building up its economy. We all agree on these objectives. The best and the only possibility to induce change we want, as frustratingly low as it may be, is the policy of constructive engagement to which we are committed. Walking away will not help the Eritrean people, nor our interest of a stable and prosper Horn of Africa. We owe this to the population of Eritrea today and tomorrow, and to ourselves, to our own interest. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now I would like to pass on the floor to our last speaker for today, and that is Ms. Latitia Bader, who is a senior researcher at Human Rights Watch at the Africa Vision. You have 8 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to the Committee on Development for inviting us to testify today about the human rights situation in Eritrea, which comes obviously at a very timely moment, given that the European Commission is moving forward with a significant new development project, which could put the European Commission in the position of facilitating an abusive system of forced labour. I will start off by discussing, based on over a decade of research, the country's uniquely abusive program of indefinite forced labor. Then talk about serious restrictions on Eritreans' other basic rights, and finish off by making recommendations to the European Union. And then I hope we will get into some technical questions around the project. As the European Parliament has clearly spelt out in 2016 and again in 2017 resolutions, the rights situation in Eritrea is one of extreme repression. So in July 2018, when the peace agreement between Ethiopia and Eritrea was signed, there was a lot of hope, that this would usher in a period of greatly needed rights reforms. 18 months later, these hopes have been dashed. Now, we are, of course, aware of the complexities of engaging in Eritrea. Complexities, I would say, that the European Union has been dealing with for over a decade and has been placing engagement as the priority for the last decade. What is very clear is that engagement with Eritrea risks bringing the European Commission into a minefield of human rights issues. So the country's national service system, by a proclamation issued in 1995, all Eritreans have to undergo 18 months of national service. So on paper, there's nothing abusive in that. But in practice, the Eritrean government disregards the proclamation's time limits. And so most Eritreans, women included, aged between 18 and 40, some younger, many older, are forced into working for the government for years, even decades. So some of the more fortunate conscripts end up being conscripted into the civil service. So teachers. Teachers in Eritrea are all forced labourers. But others, and many of them, are filling the military's rank and file and are assigned into state-owned construction companies, which is obviously very relevant for the project we are discussing today. So what does this mean? So that means none have a choice in their assignment, have a choice as to where they get deployed in the country. So imagine the impact this has on people's personal, private, family lives. But also a choice in the length of their service. But it's not just the length which is a problem, it's also the abuses they face within national service. So we looked, for example, in a 2013 report into those who were conscripted into construction companies working in the mining sector. Mining sector is obviously a very important sector in Eritrea. The workers faced terrible conditions. Inadequate food supplies, unsafe housing. The workers we spoke to, who had obviously managed to flee the country, described how they lived in fear. One was imprisoned because he left the mining site to attend his grandfather's funeral without a permission. I mean, this is also something to highlight. The government, through this system, is restricting people's every move. I would also call on members of the European Parliament to look into previous UN Security Council monitoring reports on Eritrea and look at what the reports say about the Red Sea Trading Corporation. In 2019, we investigated the impact of national service on the secondary education sector. Now, why the secondary education sector? Because basically, the last year of secondary school is the year during which students undergo military service. Some of them are still children, so this is forced conscription of children. During that year, they're under military control for the whole year. So imagine passing your baccalaureate in that sort of context. And that is basically the year that defines whether they get sent into national service down the line or into military service. Since the peace agreement, between 16,000 and 24,000 students in Eritrea have been channeled into national service. So while the government has started to pay certain categories of national service conscripts since about 2015, so the teachers we interviewed at the time had started to benefit from finally getting some sort of salary, they all said that this was still not enough to survive, but also they are subjected to very high deductions, and the government has also imposed currency controls. So those who try to leave national service posts face a whole range of reprisals, and especially those who are caught trying to flee the country, which ends up being the only way out for many forced conscripts, they risk imprisonment in dire conditions. I mean, one example was a teacher who'd spent 12 years in national service, decided to flee in late 2017. He was arrested, sent 6 months in detention. In one underground facility he was held in, he described realizing that the only way they could breathe in the evening was if he read to all the other co-detainees. And so every night he would read to them so that they had a bit of oxygen in their cell. The government has always justified national service on the basis that it was in war footing. Now it has started to argue that the economic conditions are not ripe. But I think it's important to underline that, yes, this is a form of employment in an unquestionably dire economic context. But this is also the government's main form of repression and control of its population. So far, we have not seen any evidence that the government is working to creating a civilian service system. So the government obviously uses many other tools. There's no civil society. Citizens cannot express their own views. There's no independent media. All the independent media houses were shut down in 2001. The government refuses to hold elections. The interim legislature has not met since 2002. Unlike Ethiopia, which released tens of thousands of prisoners 2 years ago, in Eritrea, there are scores of political detainees detained because of what God they believe in, what views they have expressed, or because they try to escape national service. The government has neither released nor improved the conditions of its most prominent prisoners. 11 high-level government officials and 10 journalists, including the Swedish-Eritrean journalist Dawit Isaac, who've been detained incommunicado since 2001. It has held Siham Ali Abdu, daughter of a former information minister, who was arrested age 15. Siham has been detained for the last 7 years. The EU states that the new track approach places human rights on its political agenda. But despite high-level discussions, these trends are showing no sign of abating. In fact, 2 months after the peace agreement, the government arrested Abrehe Kidane Berhane, a former finance minister, after he called for political reforms. He has not been heard from since. Since the peace agreement, the space for independent actors appears to have shrunk. And as the EU is very aware, at least one of its own partners, Finnchurch Aid, is having to withdraw from the country as we speak. Similarly, in mid-2019, after Eritrean Catholic bishops called for justice and reform from the government took over important religion-affiliated schools and confiscated all the Catholic health facilities. Now, a lot of these facilities were in parts of the country where there are no other health facilities. So, of course, the alternative for Eritreans, and the only option, really, for Eritreans, is to flee. Now, as we speak, there are thousands of Eritreans leaving the country on a monthly basis. 10% of the population, I mean, it's difficult to know because there hasn't been a census conducting in Eritrea, but what appears to be about 10% of the population are currently in exile. And young Eritreans we've spoken to again and again before the peace agreement, after the peace agreement, kept mentioning that it is the lack of freedom which is pushing them to flee. They have seen their fathers away from home for months and years at a time, and they see them struggling in this context. This is what is driving them to flee. So, of course, despite this reality, the EU appears to have chosen to accept the risk of indirectly supporting forced labour by engaging in what is one of the more problematic sectors, and accepting that not even the most basic checks and balances are in place, and we can discuss later the whole question of monitoring. The EU should do better. Measures should be put in place to ensure that the EU are not contributing to the abusive system of forced labour. At the same time, the EU should not rely on the Eritrean government, which has made commitments to the EU in the past. In 2015, commitments were made on national service. They were not complied with. Independent safeguards are needed. Reform is, of course, a process, but some reforms are purely a question of the Eritrean government's political will. Eritrea has a constitution it can implement. It has a parliament it can convene. It could release, or at a minimum, let relatives of political detainees know the fates and the whereabouts of their loved ones. The EU should be pushing for concrete evidence that the government is committed to reforming national service. Now, this can be by pushing the government to create jobs outside of national service, and I want to refer again to the Finchurch Aid project, which was a good step in that direction, and the fact that Finchurch Aid have had to close that programme is very telling of the government's commitment in this regard. It can separate schooling from conscription, and it should immediately demobilise individuals who have spent more than 5 years in service. Eritreans deserve to be free and to have their rights protected. At a time where Eritrean leaders have gained international recognition without having in any shape or form improved the life of their citizens, it is important that the EU makes clear that its support has not forgotten ordinary Eritreans. Thank you.
Thank you all for your contribution. I think they were quite to the point, all of them. I would now like to open up. There are some questions from members. Let me see. Yeah. And we start with Michel Ravasi from the Greens.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you. Thank you for those interventions, which concern the whole debate about why Europe helps some countries. Now, I asked this question back in November. I wanted you to tell me why European aid was going to defend European values. Well, we were talking about 20 million euros back then. We asked this question at the audit committee. And the response from the previous commissioner, well, first of all, she didn't want to reply, but then this is another question asked by the president of the committee. Finally, I did get a response saying, well, we have 20 million euros for these roads. It's UNOPS that is going to ensure the implementation of the motorway repairs. And then we heard, I was listening to you, but there's no office, there's no bureau in Eritrea. All you're doing is getting the equipment and taking it to the site. That's it. So if we ask how many employees, who's working for whom, and the Ministry of the Army working for the company that is directly dependent from the government, what are their wage conditions? We don't get any response. And you want us to defend European Union values. So then what do we hear? Well, it's not just 20 million euros. There's going to be an extra 60 million. So that's 80 million euros to redo these roads, to repair these roads. There were three visits, and I kept asking. I finally got the minutes from the visits, the reports, and they were told we cannot ask people what they're earning. We can't find answers to those questions. We don't know to what extent we're helping with this forced labour. So where does that leave us? What is the Commission actually doing about that? What's the committee doing? You're saying, no, it's a dual approach. Well, this is a new terminology, this dual approach. Parliamentarians like us were never asked about whether we were in favour of this dual approach. So there's one political party and then one development part to it. So I met the commissioner, and the commissioner said to me, well, we're going to have a meeting with the NGOs. This meeting then took place last Friday. and the High Representative of European Representation for Human Rights, their office said, she says, the discussions on political prisoners did not take place. We did not make any progress. The government refuses to discuss this. We don't even know the exact numbers of political prisoners. It could be thousands, could be hundreds. The government agreed to discuss national service, but it didn't promise anything. It didn't want to talk about socioeconomic aspects before demobilization. So what is socioeconomic progress given that there's no private sector? And then the UN body is hoping to work on this point, but we don't want to talk. We haven't yet talked to the Special Rapporteur for Human Rights from the UN. There is preparatory work taking place in many ministries, but the key UN recommendations have not been discussed. Nothing concrete is being proposed for the moment. And what we see on human rights, and this was said by the NGOs, there's the Catholic Church with hospitals, and the current government has come in and closed all these hospitals. Now, we are MEPs. We are politicians. How can we possibly accept this? How can we convince people that the European Union is not helping, aiding and abetting the dictatorship? Because when you're fixing the roads, you're helping the dictators. As if you were to say, well, we're going to help a particular group without any conditions because we haven't seen any progress on human rights. So you might even say that there's been a regression on human rights. The fact that all the Catholic Church health groups have been removed, all of that's been deleted. Are you really trying to tell me that by rehabilitating those roads you're helping Eritrea? I think you're actually helping the government. And we as MEPs cannot accept this. So this is why I want to see the Commissioner. This is why I proposed a mission. I proposed a mission. Either the government will refuse a mission from MEPs. And at that point, then, we could say to you, okay, they're accepting EU money, but they're also refusing at the same time a visit from MEPs. And that's going to be interesting because then we could refuse any further aid, or they accept, and then we as MEPs could go there. And of course, the government will organise it. We'll ask to go on site and talk about wages, and that would be the first international mission to Eritrea. And it would allow us to move forwards on this. So politically speaking, what we're doing here is not tenable as MEPs. Now, there are NGOs in the Netherlands who attacked me, are attacking the European Commission on this. And I think that we do need to help with forced labour. But we're being told that in the technical sheet that I read in detail, there's only 3% of workers who come from the army, and these people are not paid. So what about this forced labour? What's it all about? I think it's untenable, politically speaking.
Thank you. Charles Gerdens, Renew.
Well, I also have a question to ask the Commission. First and foremost, repairing the roads. It's not a new question, but why is China not part of this? Because they seem to be present in all the works, building sites going on in Africa. So that's my first question. Secondly, you presented the different people working on this, the Red Sea Corporation, etc., UNOPS. Now, what about the International Labour Office? I know at the time, I'm not sure what the case is today, this organisation had programmes of support for high-intensity labour that were very intensive for the labour force. And they had a lot of knowledge and expertise and could be brought in on these types of building sites. Has the Commission thought about approaching the International Labour Organization, ILO? Thirdly, following what Michel Yvazier said, I think that the political issue, and also following what the NGO has intervened on, I think that we need to follow up with a fact-finding mission to Eritrea, because I absolutely would support that type of way forwards. And then finally, what I'd like to say is, have you thought about a plan B? Commission, if this project is not continued, what would be the alternative? Have you had any assurances that you can could give us that the Eritrean government perhaps is not willing to divulge? Perhaps there's secret diplomacy going on, and perhaps you could clarify that to us in private.
Thank you. Beata Kempa is your.
Mr. Chair, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to thank for all these voices. Everything was said. I think I know a lot about this situation in African countries because of my previous responsibilities, and would like to say clearly that very often I cannot agree with the Greens, but today I absolutely agree with what my colleague said. I'd like to thank you for this report. I would like to thank especially Leticia Bada. Yes, it is true. What is happening in Eritrea, Eritrea is just one example of what European Union should not be acting. I do have close relations with the Catholic Church there, but also with other Christian churches, especially when they are working in those most difficult and most dangerous areas. They reach those who are most in need. We are talking here about important projects. I'm going to refer to this in a while. So they are reaching those in need with medical help. Medical help in Eritrea no longer exists. So we can say, what does it change that there is no war, that war finished? More people are dying today because of lack of medical care than from in the past from bombs. And then again, as far as Catholic Church is concerned, the missionaries were providing basic education for children, and that was also brutally quashed, brutally destroyed. These were because these were coordinated centers of with providing medical help, education, and also clothing and food and the like, and that was destroyed. And Madame Rivasi is right. We should go there on a mission and find out clearly, using the support and the experience of the Catholic Church, perhaps we should go and see what the government is doing there. And Mr. Chair, I would like to thank you that we have this discussion today, because the roads are very important for development of any country, and the attitude, the approach of the European Union was very good. Support, good intentions, and economic development. But today we have to check, and Madame Rivasi, you are right here again, the roads need a lot of money, and this is where we have a lot of corruption, especially in countries like Eritrea, as much as many other things, other phenomena, like slave labor, like problems with human rights. So it is very good that we are talking about Eritrea today, because soon we are going to meet Madame Urpilainen, Commissioner Urpilainen, and she is going to talk about the new strategy for Africa. And now, if we talk about this new strategy for Africa, we should also mention this problem, how we should talk about human rights in developing countries. And one more thing, and we have to mention this too. There is this locust plague coming close to Eritrea. It will not be the government suffering from that, a government which is enriching themselves also on funds from the European Union, but it will be the poor people who will suffer most. And we should have this in mind, think of our support as the European Union. So, as was rightly said by Madame Leticia Bada, we have to investigate what is happening there. I mean slave labor, this is what is happening most likely. It is a cause of migration leading to problems in Europe too, and also a problem of trafficking human beings. So we should not be talking about strategies. We should verify what the situation is there. And I would like to thank Madame Rivasi for everything she said. I fully agree that only a mission can give us the knowledge about the situation in Eritrea.
Thank you. Eric Makan, please.
Yes, thank you. I wanted to say that maybe there's a misunderstanding, because I think the discussion, and I will ask the Commission about it, but the discussion is not about if the road project is a good thing in the long term or not, but the complaints we have is why minimum standards are not respected at this project where we contribute. And I think it's not rocket science to take care of labor rights in our projects, at least to work on it a little bit harder than I heard from you that you are doing it. I heard the argument that you do not finance labor there, but I wanted to ask if it is a valid argument in contexts of slavery to say that you do not finance labor, because one of the main problems is that the labor is not financed there. Like, you can have hundreds of slaves without paying them and saying you are not financing them. That's like no argument in my case, but maybe it's a valid point for you, I don't know. And the second thing I wanted to ask, I read the action fish from the European Trust Fund for Africa, and there it is written down that this action directly responds to objectives and sustainable development goals 1, 2, 8, and 9. 8 is decent work and economic growth. I wanted to ask what part of the project responds to decent work conditions in case of the SDGs. So that's point 8 of the SDGs. And I also wanted to ask, because you also have some lessons learned things in the paper, there it is written down that the the workers are not that qualified, and that poor quality needs careful attention. But I did not find something about forced labor there, just about that maybe poor quality of the road work needs careful attention. And I wanted to ask if it's not maybe also necessary to write some words about human rights. You said it's a complex situation there. I maybe agree, but I ask myself, why are you not painting the whole picture of the complex situation, but one small part of it?
Thank you. Norbert Neusser, S&D.
Vielen Dank.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much for presenting the situation. And I'd like to thank Human Rights Watch for the very, very clear statement concerning the human rights situation. Now, the European Union is in a dilemma situation, and it's over 30 years that we've had terrible repression, a dictatorship in Eritrea, and through different measures we've tried to improve a little bit the human rights situation in Eritrea. Now, I remember within the framework of the ACP, over the last 10 years, an effort has been made to have the release of the Swedish journalist who is imprisoned there, but none of the particular steps, nothing has been of a decisive nature as far as improving the human rights situation. Now, the Commission, without the participation of the Parliament about 2 years ago, has been working together with Eritrea and the broader region in order to make available renewable energy. There were a number of different projects that were implemented, and renewable energy is good for people. That's what the Commission said, and that it would be a good project. In the end, it's turned into another government project. And I see the same thing as far as the roads. With the roads, it's a bit more complicated, because
Ethiopia has high interests in this particular issue. They want to have that access to the sea through Eritrea, so it is very, very complicated indeed. But on the other hand, it is an ambitious effort with government participation, of course, and with government participation and with the support of NGOs, civil society, we have to work with the situation there. No matter how weak civil society is, we have to work together with them. We have to exercise pressure on the government. And, of course, it's clear that there has to be conditionings. There has to be conditions attached to this aid, to this help. And I think, indeed, we have to make it clear to the government that it is absolutely necessary to do whatever they can for human rights and, of course, to work together with Ethiopia to make those particular road possibilities reality. Now, 2 years ago, we've called for a certain amount of reservation, a certain amount of restraint, rather, on a number of different issues, the role of the government, the various projects that have taken place there. And there is a delegation, a plan for a delegation to work together with the government in Eritrea and in ACP and in Ethiopia as well to improve the human rights situation. Through the Cotonou Agreement and with the pressure of the ACP, I think there's a lot that can be done for democracy, for elections, to improve the human rights situation. I think we have to use all of those implements, so to say. The parliament has to use everything there in order to improve the situation. A clear message has to be delivered that there's no cooperation with the government when we have undermining of or violation of human rights. We have to make it quite clear that humanitarian aid requires a situation where human rights are respected. And I think as well this had to be taken into consideration with regard to the fighting of the locust attacks there.
The Development Committee, but I will also say as a Swede, of course, I pay a lot of attention to Eritrea. And I mean, I do understand the difficulty when it comes to the political situation in the country. But I kind of had the same question, I think, as Madame Revasi and also Mr. Goerens, and that is basically about this dual-track approach. And basically my question is, I mean, are you making an assessment if you think that it's working or not? I mean, do you actually see a deadline, a plan B, as Mr. Goerens said? And perhaps you cannot speak about that openly here, that's fine. But I mean, basically that is of the concerns of this committee, that this is just not keep going, that we have an assessment if this is working or not. I think that is something that at least needs to be commented. I noticed that most of the questions were for the commission, basically. That was quite clear from the members. But of course, I can give everybody a short moment to give a small concluding remark, if you would like to do that after the members spoke. But I think then we go on, and then we go back then, and I give the floor again to Sandra Kramer from DEPCO.
Thank you very much, Chair. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to thank you for this discussion. It's very useful that we sit here and speak about these indeed very complicated things, as you say yourself. And I recall that we were in DEVA meetings on the 21st of January and on the 27th of February on the same issue. And so we keep your committee very much informed and we keep talking, which is very good. I also want to recall, of course, that human rights are a core principle in all EU actions. This is, of course, clear. There are some very interesting and good remarks, and I would like to take the opportunity to go into a few. What is China doing? China is there. They are in some minor road projects, and they seem to be very interested mostly in mining. That is what we can see of that. So they are there. Then I very much like the opportunity to tell you a little bit about the ILO, because of course we are in touch with the ILO, and the ILO and the government of Eritrea are also actively engaging since last year. They are discussing workers' rights and they are discussing conditions. And last year Eritrea signed the ILO Child Labour Convention, and that will enter into force in June. And for your information, the ILO plans a visit to Eritrea again in February. So that is on that. On a mission, we are very happy to facilitate a mission if you, Chair, would decide to do so. On a possible plan B or alternatives, yes, we are discussing that with the government of Eritrea. And we've made clear, as I said in my opening remarks, that more of the same is not acceptable. So continuing exactly as we are now is not acceptable. We've made that clear. There are alternatives. And I think that we can indeed discuss these when they are a bit more worked out. And I would like to leave it at that. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Then I think I will also then give the floor to Rainer Framfeld, director, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. thank you again for the opportunity to participate in this exchange and the discussion. I think they are all very relevant points. And what I wanted to say just from a general engagement perspective, there are two things that came, I mean, there are many things that came up, but one obviously was corruption. And I think the key role for UNOPS to be involved in this project is to make sure that there's no deviation of funds and that EU money, EU taxpayers' money, is protected in its application. So that is something we can certainly confirm in relation to the contribution the EU is making via UNOPS. And the second point, and that goes beyond the admittedly very narrow role of UNOPS, which is a technical organization, one of many specialized UN organizations, is that the UN at large is actively engaged in Eritrea and is alongside the EU promoting a political dialogue, is promoting a dialogue for change, and is actively seeking engagement. And there's just in 2 weeks, on the 9th and 10th of April, a conference scheduled in Nairobi that involves the Department of Political Affairs, the Labour Organization, and all UN organizations that are physically present in Eritrea to define the next phase of the joint engagement in Eritrea. And only 3 or 4 months ago, the UN Deputy Secretary General, Ms. Amina Mohammed, did visit Eritrea and had interactions with the government and is promoting a continued UN engagement, obviously, to seek to influence the government in its reform process, which is, of course, moving forward very slowly. But so this is just to say that there's a lot of engagement and there's little to show for right now, but I think, and I'm saying that outside of the technical mandate of UNOPS, which is a procurement and project management organization, the UN takes a very strong interest and works in alignment with development partners to positively influence the change, the situation in Eritrea. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Director. Then I would like also to give the floor to Letizia Boulder, please.
Thank you very much. I mean, maybe just a few points. I mean, as was just mentioned, little to show and more of the same is not possible. I think it would be very important for the Commission to feedback to the Parliament very soon in terms of what concretely, whether it's benchmarks, I know this is not a popular word in the Eritrean context, indicators, whatever we want to call them, but I think there needs to be some very concrete evidence or areas in which the Commission is going to be moving forward on. And once again, as I mentioned in my remarks, I think, you know, evidence that the government is creating jobs outside of national service. We are not talking about the possibly tens of thousands of jobs that wouldn't be needed if there is a massive demobilization. We are talking about small evidence of jobs outside. And then some very easy, concrete steps in terms of the political and civil space. On ILO, I would maybe recommend also that the Parliament speaks directly with the ILO. They have obviously found Eritrea to be in violation of the two forced labour conventions. And my understanding is the engagement at the moment is not around the forced labour convention. So I think it is also important for the Parliament to get clarification on that. I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I will also want to give the opportunity to Lotta Yashchenko, please. Please.
Merci beaucoup, madame.
Thank you very much, madame MEP Ribassi. Just one comment on the human rights dialogue, which is not really a dialogue, but these are meetings. Mr. Guillemin is quite positive on them, and he is interested, as everyone is, in carrying on these conversations. You are right, the regime must not give up the national service regime immediately, but it is a dialogue. It takes time. It's an exchange of information. He's also keen on things speeding up, and there is understanding that this is something that will take time, and it takes time to build the trust that is needed. And on that basis, at least I have the impression that he has a positive feeling. He was very happy about the meeting, and he wants to keep going on, and I hope that the interest is mutual. The same applies to political dialogue. We can't expect immediate results, but at least we can transmit a message. We can talk about how important it is to review the Constitution. There is a Constitution. You are right. We have to ask, why is it not being applied? Why is it that the Parliament is still dormant? There are things like that, little messages that we can transmit and hope that in time we can see a certain reaction. So that's one thing. Another thing that I wanted to say is that personally, I work with all of my colleagues on the committee. You do as well. You work every day to improve conditions, and we cannot be accused of supporting a dictatorship. That is not true. We do not support forced labor. That's untrue. We are all working with the intention of improving socioeconomic conditions little by little. And this will not happen if we turn away, if we say, let's give up, let's come back 10 years later and see if this dictator is dead and see if the transition has started. That's not going to change the situation. All it will do is strengthen the dark side of the regime. They, of course, will be happy if the European Union turns away. That's the way I see things. And I would like to wish you all the best with your visit. I think it's very important. And I would also like to thank you for your open mind in going there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all for your contribution today. I can promise you that our committee will continue to follow this development, of course, and also have a discussion on our future actions from the committee regarding this matter. But then we end this point for now. Okay, thank you.